Hi everyone, and welcome to another vlog for the Exodus 7-12 KJV project. In this week, I have a few. In this blog, I have a few things to talk about. Not this week. This week too, but you get the point. Anyway, so I have like 5 shots this week, and I would like to just run through these and show you guys what it looks like in 3D as well. So first of all, you guys remember that last time we talked about Aaron preparing for the shot, and then the throw. Yes, there's the throw. So I'm just going to mute all the 3D strips over here, just so we can focus on them. The shots, I mean, not the 3D ones. I'm going to show you the 3D ones, but I'm just focused on the 2D now. Okay. I just want to place that nice. Okay. So basically, just before I actually got back to work in terms of doing this stuff, I really felt like the Lord showed me that this is the way he was supposed to throw. He was supposed to bring it up to his left shoulder and chuck it forward. Not with too much emphasis, but you know, enough so that it has proper airtime, because cast means to throw. It means that there has to be forward momentum as well as some airtime. So he didn't just drop it. He threw it. He literally threw it. So anyway, so he puts it on his right shoulder, and just a little grip for a little dramatic effect, and boom, there it goes. Wah. And it flies and flies, and then we get to the next shot, which is it hitting the ground. Now, as you can see, there's glow here, and there's no glow in the landing. That's just to emphasize the fact that I'm showing he is anointed to do this, which means enabled. He is enabled by God to do this. He has the permission, you could say, to do this, and he has the enablement to do it. So this is what Pharaoh would have seen, just a stick hitting the floor. Because God is not about making a show of people. He's about he's about glorifying himself. That's what it's about. We have to glorify him. It's not about him glorifying us. Anyway, so it hits the ground. This little bounce at the end, you'll see that there's a little bit of a tap there. I'm going to page through it. You can see there that tap. That was done with Blender's bounce interpolation, which I will get to in a minute. Now, obviously, it moves a little bit too fast for the frames to keep up, but you get the point. when you see it played back, you'll see it plays well. And of course, Pharaoh is a little bit upset that he threw a stick at him, but suddenly, next shot. The rod turned into a reptile, serpent thing. I put a lot in the post about why I chose this specific animal, but just to give you the summary, the Israelites complained in the wilderness, and God sent what the scripture calls, I'll put it on screen, I think fiery burning serpents, and they bit the people, and a lot of the people died. But the Lord told Moses to make a brass serpent and put it on a pole, and whoever looks at the pole will be healed. That's also on the screen. And the people started worshiping the thing, and they gave it a name. And when I specifically asked God to show me what did Moses and Aaron use, because I don't believe he used the cobra, not to knock anyone who does do that for their animations or whatever, but the thing is, the Egyptians worshiped the cobra. They revered it. So I don't believe that God would use something that they would worship. He might have. I might be off on this, but I just didn't have peace about using that. And I felt led to go check out that instance in Numbers where Moses put up the brass serpent. So, of course, I went and checked that out and found out that it was given a name as well. And that name I Googled and found some really, really interesting resources, you know, from like old medieval scripts and that sort of thing, where the animal was depicted. And it was certainly not the typical snake we see today. It was something that resembled the Chinese zodiac dragon, very similar to that, except it was shorter, only had 2 legs, and it did have wings. So it looked a bit like what you see on screen right now, but I did more of a lizard versus a snake. If you check out the word there, it pretty much refers to a reptile, the Hebrew word. It refers to a reptilian being, which can include pretty much any lizard, snake, dinosaur type thing that is probably no longer with us. So this is what I felt led to make. It might not be this exact animal. I don't know. It really doesn't matter. The point is that I don't believe it was just a typical snake. I don't have peace about that. But again, I put it in the description, in the post about why I say that. So you can check that out. Okay, so then Pharaoh is like super impressed, which is the next shot. Like, ooh. And then he calls the magicians. Boo. Interesting about the noise before I move on with why I chose a finger snap, or why I was led to use a finger snap. Blender Render doesn't have that animate noise sample or noise seed. It doesn't have that feature. So unfortunately, you have to crank up the samples to get super smooth results. And I just don't have the computing power. So I use about 7 samples, which is generally good enough, but sometimes it's a little bit lacking, especially when you up the contrast of something. You can see it's better in here than over here. So, just one of those things. Thankfully, it does look better if you put it on full render. Look at that. So you'll barely even notice it. It's a lot better than what I had in Esther. In Esther, I only used 5 samples. So, yikes. Anyway, so the reason I used a finger snap instead of, you know, him yelling at somebody is because there is no dialogue in scripture for Pharaoh's calling of the magicians. If you go look at the meaning of that word, it means to, as it's written, call for somebody. You know, there's a summoning that took place. There's a request, and it was very clear, if I can put it that way. So because there's no dialogue, and because I don't know what exactly he did, there's a very open way of doing it. And I really felt led to use a snap. I don't know why, but that's just the thing I have peace about. So I used the snap, and because Pharaoh himself was involved in many rituals and stuff like that, it would probably have the demonic influence to be able to do all sorts of stuff himself as well. So, of course, he summons them with a snap. Whoop-a! And, of course, we enter into the last shot for the week where, of course, they make a grand entrance. Now, the reason it's kind of slow motion-y is because the shot is too quick. So what I did was I used speed strips to half the speed, and I used the, I'm going to call it the lazy man's motion blur to just give it a little bit more smoothness. The shot will only go up to about here, but I do feel that God has given me a little bit of leading here, where I'm going to take it back to its original speed, where it's just like boom, you know, and then it's up. But from 3 different angles, so it will be like boom, 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 you know, from this shot from, or this can be the last one, but we have a shot of the first one, and then we have one from the top, and then we have one from a different angle. I'm not exactly sure which way, where to go on this, but that'll probably be the first thing to do for this week. So interesting about the 3D stuff. I'm going to switch to the 3D for a quick second, specifically with these last two, with the magicians. As you can see, this is yellow. You can also see the same in the transformation. So I'm going to Alt-H this one as well. The reason I used yellow is because colors like this pink over here and red cause what is known as retinal rivalry. Basically, what that means is your eyes see different things and your brain tries to make sense of it. So it's like there's a fight going on between what your eyes are seeing and what your brain is understanding from what you're seeing. Mm-hmm. So primary colors, especially red and even blue, can do that sometimes. But for some reason, it just doesn't do well, the red. So initially I made it like a fuchsia color. You know, if you looked at it like this, just normal 2D. But that fuchsia color made the whole thing blue, but it also made these flames blue in Pharaoh's throne room. And it didn't make sense. So I felt led to change it to yellow, which was anyway more harmonious between the eyes and anyway. And it still retained a lot of Moses's original color with the blue. So this is what I used. It's just a hue adjustment in the compositor. You can see that it starts out red over there as it keyframes into the yellow. So I'm going to be showing you this as a 2D, and then I'm going to show you the 3D one. Ah, that is so cool. First things first, though, you can see the consistency between the landing, the throwing and the landing. The reason it's so consistent is I believe God gave it to me as a sign. I wanted to know whether the throw that Aaron did was fast enough, because it kind of felt a little bit sluggish to me. But when I saw the consistency of the throw and the landing, I just knew, nope, it's perfect, because I didn't even reference back to it, like not at all. And it fits perfectly. So I took that as a sign. This is the way it's supposed to be. That's the way I'm leaving it. So that was just super awesome. before I switch to the 3D one, I'm going to show you 3D one first, and then I'm going to talk about the bounce interpolation. Okay, there you go. There we have the 3D one. So it's only about 28 seconds, but 28 seconds for a week in terms of rendering and animation is, yikes, it's a lot of work. But anyway, I'm going to play you guys this. I'm going to play it about twice. Oh, that's very cool. I like that. Now, interesting, when 3D moves, you don't get the same consistency as you would when you're just looking at a 2D image. I'm going to show you an example of what I mean. Look at the transformation. When he starts there, when he gets there, look at that. Look at the difference between the wing close to you and the face. There's a huge gap between the two. But look at what happens when you play it back. You kind of lose that sense of depth. So what I'm trying to do, at least from now, is to try and get the effect as strong as possible before rendering out, so that it's as strong and visually noticeable as possible. Otherwise, it's kind of pointless to watch the 3D version if you're not going to see any real effect. Now, as you can see with Pharaoh over here, I have quite an intense effect, so it's immediately noticeable. The same here. The only problem is we do have some visual artifacts, especially around Moses and Aaron. It's kind of like one eye sees Aaron and another eye doesn't. But that's what happens when you use distortion anyway. So it's just a little bit But anyway, it's just one of those things. I really do try to get the stuff as good as possible. I mean, look at the difference between his hand and his jacket. Yeah. Anyway, let's get to the bounce interpolation. Okay, so let's say we have the plane and we want the plane to bounce. We just need to shrink it down so we can actually see it. There we go. Okay, so let's say we want the frame to bounce. So I'm going to say location, and I'm going to put it at, say, 40. I'm going to bring it down, and I'm going to say location. Now, typically, this is what it will look like. That's it. Nothing fancy. So that's entry level right there. So what you now need to do is you need to go into the graph editor, and you can see immediately which one is our Z. It's the blue one. And you need to select the two points that you want the bounce to occur on. So I'm going to select these two, and I'm going to press T. And I'm going to select dynamic effects, bounce. And this is what happens. Unfortunately, I don't know how to increase the number of bounces. I really don't. I think it's supposed to increase. No, it does not. I don't know. I think it's just these few bounces. But even if you add another keyframe in there, you can see it doesn't change that. And there's no rotating it. There's no scaling it. There's no changing any of this. It's just... That's the way it is. If you want to add more bounces, you can always simply copy these by sort of drawing over it. Anyway, so this is a double level bounce. I like that. That's very cool. So next time you have something that needs to bounce, like the end of a stick or something else, this is definitely a very useful tool. As you can see, the results are fantastic. It's not even, wow, you know. And just to show it doesn't have to apply to every keyframe you have, I'm going to set this to Bezier, which is the typical one. Let's use Elastic, just for the sake of being cool. Okay. So I'm just going to move all this within the frame range. Okay, so let's check the elastic one. It's a little bit short, so I'm just going to extend it. Oh, the elastic one's interesting. Look at that. Let's just use this one to be busier. Okay. And no, let's make it vector. No, vector. Automatic. Okay, let's do this. Look at this. Okay, so it's going to come down to the camera. That's so cool. I like the elastic one. So as you can see, you can use these things to really improve your workflow. So have at it. So another thing I want to talk about is these backgrounds. Now, you guys remember that I talked about action lines in a previous tutorial, which you can find in the post as well. I think I put it in the description as well. So you can easily render these. It doesn't take a lot of time. I think it's under 3 seconds per frame full HD. It's crazy fast. Anyway, so there's a way to change the color of these without having to render a special one every time you need to get a different color or a different direction or anything like that. So I'm going to show you how to change the color of these backgrounds without having to re-render the whole thing. Now, I did this within the compositing area, not the the VSE, because obviously it needs to be put together. You can see with the transformation that I made it yellow for the 3D version. There's nothing but a U-shift here, so it's not complicated. It's not complicated at all. So this is how you do it. Okay, so here we have it. Now, typically, you would think, oh, it's easy. Let's just chuck in a hue saturation, a value node, and just change the hue. It's so simple. But look at what happens when you change it. You can see there's a color difference within the center. So if you want to make it red, for example, it's got this pinkish kind of purple. There we go, like that, in the center. That's horrible. Absolutely horrible. I don't want that. So the simple way to fix it, and it's not that Blender's tools are faulty. That's the way that this is interpreted. It's the same in GIMP, actually. One of the tools in Blender is the same as in GIMP. So the way to change this is by using a mix node and switching to hue. And then you pick a color. So, for example, let's go for red, for yellow, green, blue. You can see it's very consistent. So that's the best way to change the color. Unfortunately, with this one, you can change the direction. If you want to, you can scale it up and move it around. But because we already have a fairly large open center, it's not the best. So what you can do with the other one is you can simply scale it up a little bit as it rotates. So, for example, let's say we want it to be, say, like, let's say we want it to be from corner to corner, something like that. Then you just need to scale it up. You want to aim for something that accommodates as much of the video as possible while still getting the angle that you're looking for. Like so. There you have it. You don't have to do a brand new render to get a different angle or a different color. It's only with the bright spot with the center. The only way to change that one is to make sure that the bright spot is as small as possible. That way you can pull the same zoom trick as with this one. There's one thing I almost forgot to mention, actually. I'm glad that I write these topics down before I actually start recording. You guys remember I had a bit of a flickering problem with some chairs last week. God showed me the solution. There is a bit of a bug in Blender when it comes to the particle system, but it's not the problem I had. The problem I had was me. So I'm going to show you what the shot looks like now. Okay, then he says, show a miracle for you. And, oh, I also added a little bit of a softer incoming and exit for show a miracle for you. It was a little bit too harsh. It felt like a signal cut out. I didn't want it to feel that way. So anyway, there we go. This specific chair flickered like crazy. Isn't it great? Just love it. So unfortunately, this was a re-render for the week. Actually, I did re-render two things. I'll talk about the next one in a second. But I'm so glad he showed me what the problem was. Basically, the problem was this. Whenever you have a plane, I'm using a plane, and you have a few sections on that plane. You can see that I have one, let's count how many vertices. We have 10 vertices, okay? Five on each side. So let's say I want this monkey distributed across the surface. So I'm going to add a particle system, and I'm going to say I only want 10 vertices. It's not supposed to be random, but we want it to be on the vertices, not random. Okay, so they all have to appear at the same time. Their lifetime is also as small as possible. And we don't want any physics whatsoever. We want to be at showing dead and unborn particles as well. Okay, so let's pick our Suzanne. Boom. Make her bigger. And there you have it. Now, the problem is that sometimes Blender likes to double place a particle, and I don't know why that happens, but sometimes it really does genuinely happen. But my problem was I had 14 particles for 10 vertices. So mine did this. Now, look at the, you don't see the, the extra one, you're done. But as soon as you turn on the environment lighting and the ambient occlusion and all that kind of stuff, the thing starts flickering like crazy because it's two objects that are literally placed on top of each other, and Blender doesn't know what to do with that information because it's physically impossible. The algorithms just don't know what to make of it. So it's different in every frame, causing that weird flickering effect. So it's Blender was innocent in terms of the chairs flickering. That was my bad. The fact that that chair flickered was not Blender's fault. That God clearly showed me that was me. Blender's innocent. But it was certainly interesting to see. So this is pretty much how you distribute something as well. We all make stupid mistakes. Okay, so anyway, getting back to the re-render, the other re-render. Now, the other re-render I did this week was this one for two reasons. Number one, Serpent was missing. Number two, nobody else was moving. And number three, the cloud was moving in a really, really weird way. Stranger than this, it kind of made like a fountain, but the turning over of the particles as it was released and came down was way too fast. The whole thing looked ridiculous. So I couldn't use it. It was too fast. It was terrible. I just couldn't use it. So this is the newer one, which is also too fast. But like I said, I already slowed it down, and I'm going to be doing probably getting it back to its normal speed and doing two other angles as well, making this one the third one. So I'll probably keep it at its normal speed right now. So that's it for this week. Have a great one, and God bless you.